Father, what a gift and a privilege it is to come before your word. Lord, I pray that in this time you would be honored and you would be glorified. We thank you for the gift of your gospel. We thank you for the privilege of being called yours. I pray, Lord, that those who hear this message would be moved with a deeper desire to know you, a deeper desire to serve you, and ultimately, God, that they would move their personal desires to the side. Jesus, it is because of you these prayers can be heard. And it is because of you, Lord, that we have the gift of your Spirit. It's in your name that we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen. Now, church, good morning. My name is Charles, and I have the privilege of serving here at Restoration Church as the Director of Intentional Missions, Families, and Equipping. It's a fancy way to say, I'm here to serve you. We're so thankful that you're here, and today we will be walking through Exodus chapter 3. Specifically, we're looking at verses 1 through 15. Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. And the word of God says, "Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey. To the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now, behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, but I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. I'll stop there. So, church, as the book of Exodus opens up, we see that God's people are suffering under Egyptian bondage. We see that God's people had been in slavery for almost 400 years. In addition to that, we see the preparation and the call of Moses and his role in leading the Israelites out of Egypt. In chapters 1 through 2 of Exodus, we see the enslavement of the Israelites and the means by which God would use to free his people. Now see, God would free his people not just from the captivity of their oppressors, but ultimately, church, he would free them from the captivity of their sin. We see that Moses grew up with a pretty privileged life. He was likely educated by some of the most brilliant minds and had influence because of where God had placed him. Now, by the end of chapter 2 in the book of Exodus, we see that Moses was abandoned so as to save his life, and we see that he was saved so as to give his life. But not before he was cast out into the wilderness and torn from everything he had known, from the comforts and the life that he had come to find as a normal day. Moses was torn away from these things. Now, to no surprise, when God began preparing Moses, when God began building him up for the task at hand, Moses had no idea. And when God called out to Moses to go and lead the Israelites out of Egypt, naturally, Moses was filled with 1,000 emotions. You see, Moses knew his weaknesses, but so did God. Moses knew how many times he failed, but so did God. And what you see, not just in Exodus chapter 3, but all throughout Scripture, is that it was never about what Moses could do. In the New Testament, it was never about what the disciples could do. Church, it was always about what God could do and what God would do through the faithfulness and obedience of his people. So before we jump into Exodus chapter 3, I want to share a story about a time when I too saw nothing but my weaknesses, a time when I saw nothing but my failures. And God quickly reminded me that if he called me, that if he sent me, then I could rest in the promise that he was with me. Amen? Amen. So in January 2021, I was accepted into a chaplaincy program at Baptist Hospital right here in Homestead. Now, I had been thinking about doing chaplaincy work, which is providing spiritual care in a hospital setting, for some time. I think it was about 8 years at this point. I had been thinking about this. But for whatever the reason, God led me in every other direction. But now, a year into COVID, I was presented with an opportunity to serve in such a way. And I felt everything you could imagine. You see, I was humbled to be accepted into the program. And I was terrified to be accepted into the program. I was excited to experience ministry from this perspective. And I was fearful. And I was fearful to work with the sick. I was fearful to tend to those who were dying. But I knew that for whatever the reason, God had called me to this season. And for whatever the reason, God had sent me to this place. I was fearful, but here we are. And so about a month into serving in the hospital, I was told that I would be on call for the next week, which basically meant that at any point in time, my phone could ring and I would be called to the hospital to be with those who were in need. Now, church, here's the thing. It was very likely that if I was called, I would probably be with someone on one of the worst, if not the worst day of their life. And church, and I was terrified. Less than 48 hours after I was told that I would be on call, my phone rang and my heart stopped. And I prayed like I have never prayed before. You see, I was told that there was a family who had just lost someone and asked to see a chaplain. I remember how nervous I was as I got dressed to leave. I remember how nervous I was when I got in the car to go. And on the way there, I called my supervisor and I said, hey, the hospital just called and they said that someone had passed away and they wanted to see a chaplain. And she said, okay, so are you on your way? And I said, well, yeah, but could you send someone else? Like, does it have to be me? And she said, no. She said, Charles, you're the chaplain on call tonight. And I said, I don't know what to say. I feel like I barely know what to do. Like, I don't even know. And I start rambling, and she cuts me off, and she says, Charles, breathe. She said, God has prepared you for this moment. A true story. I'll never forget this. She said three things. She said, pray with them, listen to them, and just be present. And so now, and I'm walking into the hospital, and under my breath, as I'm walking into the hospital, pray with them, listen to them, just be present. Pray with them, listen to them, just be present. Church, I'm freaking out at this moment. I am freaking out. When I got inside, I had no idea where to go. And so I walked up to the nurse's station, and a woman behind the desk, I'll never forget this, the woman behind the desk, she looked at me and she says, well, who are you? And church, I thought this was the most valid and accurate question to ask me at this moment. I mean, who am I? Like, what am I doing here? I have no idea what I'm doing here. And all of these thoughts that I'm having, but on the surface, all I said was, well, I'm the chaplain. And so she led me to this room, and then she left me at the door. And I remember feeling like, wait, you're not staying? Where are you going? She left me there. Amazing. Now, church, here's the thing. When I went inside the room, everything changed. I stood at the foot of the bed, and there was a man there who had recently passed away. On my left was his son and grandson, and on my right was his wife of 40 years. What do I say? What do I do? Again, pray, listen, be present. And so I prayed, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And I kept praying. And then we spoke about his life and all the ways that he had been a blessing to his family. And they wept, and I stayed. You see, church, I was exactly where I needed to be. I was exactly where God called me to be. And to be honest with you, family, I don't know why he called me to that space, to that family, to that room. I don't know why, but to this day, I do know, and I have no doubts that God was with me in that moment. And so with all that in mind, let us turn to Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. And he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Now stop there. So Moses is tending to sheep in the wilderness, and he finds himself at the mountain of Horeb. The mountain of God is what it's called, right? And we have to understand that Moses, he grew up in the house of Pharaoh, and he probably never envisioned himself being a shepherd. Again, Moses was probably a pretty educated man. It's likely that Moses ate the finest fruits in all of Egypt. Moses was likely showered with the finest things. And yet here he was, in the wilderness, when the angel of the Lord called out to him through a burning bush that was not consumed. And God called out to him from a burning bush. Now, church, what we have to understand, what we have to know, is that all of the privileges and all of the things of this world could not have prepared Moses for what God was going to do through him. And so God pulled him from his comforts, and God sent him to the wilderness so that God could prepare him, so that God could equip him. But first, God had to strip him of all the things that Moses used to define himself so that he could be defined by God. You see, Moses thought that he was running from his past. And what he learned on that mountain, what he learned in the wilderness, was that God was preparing him for his future. Now let's go back to verse 3. And Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called out to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. Stop there. Church, we have to understand that God positioned himself so that Moses would notice. You see, it is not that we draw near to God, but that God, through his grace and ultimately through Christ Jesus, has drawn near to us, close enough for us to even notice. We also see through this text that when God calls us, it is not absent of direction or instruction. Look at verse 5. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. You see, not only does God prohibit us, does he stop us from coming near him as fallen, sinful people. Not only that, but God calls for reverence, which is a deep respect for who he is. God says, take your sandals off your feet and respect my house. Respect my presence. In the same breath, when Moses stood before the burning bush, when he heard God call out to him, he lowered his face, likely from fear, likely from shame, but undoubtedly from the radiance that is God the Father. You see, not only does God require us to have a deep reverence for who he is, a deep respect when we come to him. You see, God requires us to be aware of our sin, to be aware that we are unworthy to even lift our faces before a holy God. In the presence of God, we aren't even worthy outside of Christ. And so let's go back to Exodus chapter 3. We're looking at verses 7 through 9. And the word of God says, "Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now, behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them." Stop there. Now, see, I love this. Look at the intimacy of the God that we serve. So God says to Moses, I have seen their affliction. I have heard their cry. I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them. This is the God that we serve, a God who is not absent nor unaware of the trials of his people, a God who sends the faithful to show and speak of his faithfulness. Now look at verse 10. God says, "Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." Now stop there. Church, what do you think Moses is thinking at this point? So let's recap. So Moses just saw the angel of the Lord reveal himself through a burning bush that was not consumed. He found himself in the presence of God. He was told by God that God had seen everything, even Moses' sin. Moses is also standing on holy ground, barefoot, scared to move for fear of death. Moses is exposed to the power of God only to be told by God that I'm going to send you. What? Moses must be thinking, I can't make a bush burn and it's not consumed. Moses must be thinking, I can't make this mountain holy ground. It was less than 10 minutes ago that Moses hid his face from God because he was afraid. And so Moses had a natural reaction to such a call. Now look at verse 11. "But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?" Moses says, who am I? I can't do any of these things, God. I'm just a shepherd. Moses says, who am I? And Moses was about to learn a valuable lesson about what it means to be a child of God. And so that leads me to my first point, and I pray and I hope that you are taking notes. And my first point today, family, is that God often leads us into places in which we have no choice but to lean on him. Again, God often leads us into places in which we have no choice but to lean on him. You see, Moses was standing at a distance before a holy God. Moses was standing on holy ground, not because the mountain was special, not because of anything Moses had done, but because the presence of God was there. You see, God had been preparing Moses for this moment, long before he was sent into the wilderness, long before he was cast out of Egypt, long before Moses was even born. God was equipping him to go. And so Moses' question, who am I? Well, it shows us something else. Moses' question shows us, and this is my second point today, Moses' question shows us that often when God sends us, it reveals within us all the places in which we aren't trusting him. Again, often when God sends us, it reveals within us all the places in which we aren't trusting him. Church, it reveals all the places in which we are leaning on our own understanding. And so let's go back to the text, because it is all there. In verse 12, God says, he said, but I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Now stop there. So Moses asked God, well, who am I? And God says, but I will be with you. Now here's the thing. Here's the thing. That should have been enough. Because here's the thing, church, if God is with me, it matters very little who I am or what I think I can do. If God is with me, it matters very little what I've done or what I've failed to do, because God is with me. It should have been enough. But what we see from the life of Moses, what we see is that often when God calls us, it brings us face to face with our sin, face to face with our weaknesses and our failures. But just like us, Moses had questions. And just like us, Moses had doubts. But for every question that Moses asked, God reveals something about the depth of his grace. For every question, God reveals something about the nature of his character. You see, church, when we have been called by God, it brings us into his presence. And it's in his presence, and this is my third point, it's in his presence that we see not just that he has gone before us, but that he is actively with us. When we are called into the presence of God, what we see, what we learn, is not just that he has gone before us, but that he is actively with us. And so knowing this, knowing that God has gone before us, knowing that he is with us, regardless of the season, regardless of the storm, if we know this, I have to ask you, whom shall we fear? Who is it that you doubt? Because God is with us. And so let's go back to the text. Verses 13 through 15. Then Moses said to God, if I come to the people of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And so God also said to Moses, say this to the people of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and thus I am to be remembered throughout all generations. Stop there. So even after God himself called Moses, Moses doubted. Even after God told Moses that he would be with him, Moses doubted. Moses goes on to say, he says, what am I going to say if they ask who sent me? And God says, I am who I am. Tell the people, I am has sent me to you. So the title that God gives himself here has huge significance. All throughout Scripture, what we see is we see the various names of God that he takes, that he gives himself. And what we find is that they are intimately connected to the various needs of all those whom he calls his own. And so all throughout Scripture, we see these names of God. We see these different meanings and what they mean for us as his people. In Scripture, we see Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide. We see Jehovah Shalom, which means the Lord send peace. We see Jehovah Ra, which means the Lord is my shepherd. And we see Jehovah Rapha, which means the Lord that heals. And so when God says, I am who I am, when God says, I am, it encompasses them all. Because he is all things to all people. Because he always was, always is, and forever shall be. And so if God says, I will be with you, again, I ask you, whom shall you fear? Again, I ask you, who is it that you doubt? Because God is with you. You see, church, to be a child of God is to be called by God, to be sent by God, to carry out the will of God to the glory of God alone. To eat of his bread and to drink of his blood and to rest in his presence, ultimately family, to be a child of God is to be set apart from the world. This is what it means. The truth that he is with us and how that motivates our steps and our thoughts and our actions. Now, something that matters to me when I come before you is that I would speak from a place of truth, that I would ultimately lead from my brokenness. And so, church, I don't want to speak as if this walk of ours, as if this call on our lives is all roses. Because anyone who has been walking with the Lord for some time, they will tell you there are undoubtedly some thorns. And so that leads me to my fourth point today, and that is that obedience to the call of God will undoubtedly cost you something, if not everything. Again, obedience to the call of God will undoubtedly cost you something, if not everything. And so the life of Moses, it shows us, the life of Moses shows us that obedience, it comes down to trust. Do you trust him enough to obey? Do you trust him enough to believe not only that he is with you, but that he has gone before you? Do you trust him enough? Because there's something about this life, there's something about our failures that makes it easy to forget this truth. You see, the enemy whispers into our ear. He says, but who are you? Who are you that God would save you? Who are you that God would heal you? Who are you that God would forgive you? And God says, but I am with you. And so the enemy whispers again. He says, but who are you? Your marriage fell apart. You're divorced. The enemy whispers. He says, who are you? You have a strained relationship with your children. Who are you? You barely talk to your parents. The enemy whispers. He says, who are you? You used to be an addict. The enemy says, who are you? You don't even read your Bible. And God says, but I am with you. And so all of our failures, all of our weaknesses, here we are. And the enemy says, who are you? And I encourage you, church, to be reminded that God is with you. I don't know where you are today. I don't know the valley you're in. I don't know the struggle that you face, but I know that God is there. And so here we are, full of our doubts. We're full of our weaknesses in church. Quite frankly, we are covered in our sin. Here we are, once again, at the foot of the cross, in need of saving, in need of healing. Here we are, once again, with all of our brokenness. And church, it is such a privilege to let you know that by the grace of God, I have good news. And so the Bible tells us that those who have faith in Christ will be brought into the presence of the Lord. The Bible tells us that those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God can have freedom from the bondage of sin. We see in the book of Romans that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Wherever you are, right now, where you are, if you would confess with your mouth, if you would believe in your heart, the Bible tells us that you will be saved. In John chapter 14, we see that Jesus says, "I am the way." He says, "I am the truth, and I am the life." Jesus lets us know that no one comes to the Father except through me. And so, church, we are sent. We are sent because the I am has called us. We are sent because the I am is with us. Again, obedience to the call of God will undoubtedly cost you something, if not everything. And here's the thing, it cost us something because God has given everything when he sent his Son to die on the cross for you. When he sent his Son to die on the cross for me, to die in our place, not because he needed us, but because we needed him. This is grace. This is the love of God made complete in and through the Son of God. Church, you are sent into all the relationships that scare you. You are sent into all the houses that stress you. You are sent into all the places that need to experience the love and the grace of Christ. You are sent into all the places in which all you have to rely on is the love and the grace of God, because it was never about what you could do. It was always about what God would do through the faithfulness and the obedience of his people. If we would be a people who would just repent and believe. It was never about what you could do, never about your failures. It has always been about what Christ has done, what Christ will do. And so I ask you, again, I ask you, will today be the day? Will today be the day that you believe not only that he has gone before you, but that he is actively with you? Even now, I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through. But will today be the day that you will have faith to say, he is with me? Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this time. I thank you for the gift of your word, God, that we would be reminded that you have gone before us, that you are with us, God. That it wasn't about our weaknesses and the thousand times that we failed you, God. You have called us to be faithful because you have been faithful to us. And so, Father, I pray that whoever hears this message, God, that they would be encouraged to walk through your word, to rest in your truth, and to believe your promises. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for the gospel. And I pray, Lord, that we would be a people who reflect you in all that we do, in all that we say, and ultimately, God, in who we are. It is in your name, your holy name, that I pray these things. And all God's people said, Amen. Church, God bless you.